if f is bounded on the closed interval a comma b and has finite number of points of discontinuity on the closed interval a comma b, then the function f is integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Let us prove this statement. Proof: since f is bounded on the closed interval a comma b, it has infimum and supremum on the closed interval a comma b. Let infimum of the function f on the closed interval a comma b, let infimum of f be small m and the supremum of the function f be capital M. Since f is discontinuous on the closed interval a comma b, this infimum of the function small m is not equals to the supremum of the function capital M. Let us consider the given function f is the straight line. It can be a curve also, but here for the clarity and the simplicity sake, we consider the function f as the straight line containing many points of discontinuity. Let us consider the given closed interval a comma b. Let c1 comma c2 comma c3 so on cp be an ordered set of points of discontinuity of the function f in the closed interval a comma b. It is given that the function f has a finite number of points of discontinuity. Let us take it has p points of discontinuity. This is the first point of discontinuity. Since it is an ordered pair, we have to take c1, c2, c3, so on, cp in the same order. This is the first point of discontinuity. Therefore, this is c1. This is the second point of discontinuity, that's nothing but C2. This is the third point of discontinuity, let us take it as C3. So on, this is the last point of discontinuity, namely CP. Let epsilon be greater than 0, we know epsilon is positive however small. And C1 is not equals to A and CP is not equals to B. The reason is C1 is the first point of discontinuity. We cannot start the interval with the point of discontinuity because we are given the closed interval A comma B. Similarly, the last point, namely B, cannot be CP because this point cannot be the point of discontinuity. Therefore, C1 is not equals to A and CP is not equals to B. We enclose these points of discontinuity. We have a P points of discontinuity, namely C1, C2, C3, so on, CP. Now we are going to enclose these P points of discontinuity in P non-overlapping intervals, the closed interval A1 comma B1. That is, we are going to enclose the point C1 by the closed interval A1 comma B1. This interval A1 comma B1. Thus, we have enclosed the point of discontinuity C1 by the closed interval A1 comma B1. Similarly, the second point of discontinuity, namely C2, is enclosed by the closed interval A2 comma B2. So, this is A2, this is B2. Similarly, C3 is enclosed by the closed interval A3 comma B3. So on, and the last point of discontinuity, namely CP, is enclosed by the closed interval AP comma BP. And remember that here the closed intervals A1 B1 A2 B2 A3 B3 so on AP BP are non-overlapping intervals such that the sum of their lengths A1 to B1, A2 to B2, A3 to B3, AP to BP is less than epsilon by 2 times capital M minus small m. Capital M is a supremum, small m is a infimum. Let us call this expression as 1. Just now we have enclosed the C points of discontinuities, namely C1, C2, C3, CP by P non-overlapping intervals, namely closed interval A1, B1, the closed interval A2, B2, the closed interval A3, B3, so on, the closed interval AP by BP. The function f is continuous in each of the rest of the sub intervals. What are the rest of the sub intervals? A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, so on, BP, B. These are the rest of the sub intervals. They are P plus 1 in numbers. Therefore, look at this here. It is continuous. Only the closed interval A1, B1 contain point of discontinuity, namely C1. Whereas, in this interval A2, A1, the function is continuous. Similarly, in the interval B1, A2, the function is continuous. In the interval B2 to A3, it is continuous. So on, in the interval BP to B, it is continuous. F is continuous in each of the P plus 1 sub intervals, namely A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, so on, BP, B of the closed interval A, B. Since every continuous function is integrable, there exists a partitions P1, P2, P3, so on, P plus 1 of these sub intervals. P1 is a partition of the closed interval A2, A1. P2 is a partition of the closed interval B1, A2. P3 is the partition of the closed interval B2, A3, so on. P plus 1 is the partition of the closed interval BP, B. Such that U(P, R, F) - L(P, R, F) is less than epsilon by 2 times P plus 1, where R is from 1 to P plus 1. We know that every continuous function is integrable, and hence by necessary and sufficient condition of a bounded function to be Riemann integrable, this is integrable, that is U(P, F) - L(P, F) is less than epsilon. Now here we have P plus 1 partitions. Therefore, the function is continuous in each of the sub intervals. Therefore, U(P, R, F) - L(P, R, F) is less than, in fact, epsilon. Here we have taken epsilon by 2 times P plus 1 because it has P plus 1 partition. Also, epsilon is less than 0, which is very small. Epsilon by 2 times P plus 1 is positive and much less than epsilon. Therefore, if you take U(P, R, F) - L(P, R, F) is less than epsilon by 2 times P plus 1, it is no harm at all. That is no problem at all. Let us call this expression as 2. Let small mr and capital mr be the bounds of f in the closed interval AR, BR containing the rth point of discontinuity CR, where R is from 1, 2, 3, so on, up to P. Let P be the set containing the points A, A1, B1, A2, B2, AP, BP, B. Be a partition of the closed interval A, B. That is, we consider this diagrammatic representation, the partition P contains all the points except the points of discontinuities, namely C1, C2, C3, so on, CP. That is, P contains A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3, so on, AP, BP, B. So this is the partition we are going to consider for the closed interval A, B. The subintervals divided by P can be divided into two groups. The first set of subintervals is closed interval A1, B1, A2, B2, so on. The closed interval AP, BP, which is represented by 1 in the previous slide. That is, all the P subintervals given by the expression 1. And the second set of subintervals contains all the P plus 1 subintervals given by 2. That is, the subintervals A, A1, the closed interval B1, A2, the closed interval B2, A3, so on, the closed interval BP, B. Therefore, the partition P is divided into two groups. The first group contains subintervals which has P points of discontinuity in P non-overlapping intervals. The second group contains all the P plus 1 subintervals given by 2 in which the function F is continuous. That is, the first group contains the intervals which are not continuous. The second group contains all the intervals in which the function F is continuous. This partition P consists of 2P plus 2 partition points. The reason is, leaving A and B, if you consider the rest of the points A1, B1, A2, B2, so on, AP, BP. If you consider the suffixes, 1 is repeated twice, 2 occurs twice, P occurs twice. That is, each suffix occurs twice. There are P suffixes, therefore 2P points plus A, that is plus 1, 2P plus 1, plus B, that is plus 1, that is 2P plus 2. And hence, this partition P consists of 2P plus 2 partition points. Now, our aim is to show that the function which is bounded on the closed interval A, B and has a finite number of points of discontinuity is Riemann integrable. To show that the function F is Riemann integrable, we are going to use the necessary and sufficient condition for a bounded function to be Riemann integrable is that the difference of upper dot box sum minus lower dot box sum is less than epsilon. Therefore, now let us consider 0 less than or equal to UPF minus LPF, that is equals to. Since this partition P consists of two groups, the first group is containing P non-overlapping intervals and the second group contains P plus 1 subintervals in which in each of these subintervals, the function F is continuous. The subintervals divided by P can be divided into two groups. The first one is all the P subintervals given by 1, that is having P points of discontinuity, and all the P plus 1 subintervals given by the expression 2, which contains P plus 1 continuous subintervals and has P plus 1 partitions. So the first group contains P points of discontinuity. The second group contains P plus 1 partitions. Therefore, the UPF can be written as sigma r equal to 1 to P plus 1 U of P r comma F, because the second group contains P plus 1 partition and in which the function F is continuous. The first group contains P points of discontinuity. It has P subintervals. Each one is having one point of discontinuity. Therefore, we can write sum R equals to 1 to P capital M R into delta R. This is for the first group and this expression is for the second group. The first group we are writing the sum R equal to 1 to P. 1 to P because it has P subintervals and each subinterval has one point of discontinuity. Whereas the second group contains P plus 1 subintervals and it has P plus 1 partitions. Similarly, we can write the same expression for L of P comma F, that is minus sigma R equal to 1 to P plus 1 L of P R comma F plus sigma R equal to 1 to P small m r into delta R. The above expression can be written as that is equals to sigma R equal to 1 to P plus 1 U of P R comma F plus sigma R equal to 1 to P m r delta R. Now we are going to multiply it by this minus sign. Therefore, it is minus sigma R equal to 1 to P plus 1 L of P R comma F minus into plus is minus. Therefore, minus sigma R equal to 1 to P M R into delta R. Now we are going to group into two terms. The first term consists of all the upper dot box sum and the lower dot box sum. That is sigma R equal to 1 to P plus 1 U of P R comma F minus L of P R comma F plus the second group is sigma R equal to 1 to P capital M R delta R minus sigma R equal to 1 to P small m R delta R. But in these two terms, delta R is a common factor, therefore we write plus sigma R equal to 1 to P capital M R minus small m R into delta R. We have already taken U of P R comma F minus L of P R comma F is less than epsilon by 2 times P plus 1, where R is equals to 1 comma 2 comma 3 to P plus 1. Therefore, now we are going to write this expression as less than epsilon by 2 times P plus 1. Generally, we take epsilon, but here we are taken epsilon by 2 times P plus 1. Why have taken P plus 1? Because the R is from 1 to P plus 1. There are P plus 1 sum. This sum consists of P plus 1 terms. Therefore, you have taken P plus 1 here. Why you have taken 2 here? Because there are two groups. This is the first group. This is the second group. Now, our aim is to show that U of P comma F minus L of P comma F is less than epsilon. To get less than epsilon, we are taken the sum as epsilon by 2 times P plus 1 because this has P plus 1 sum. There are two terms. Here we get 1 by 2, here we get 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 is 1. That sake only we are taken epsilon by 2 times P plus 1. This P plus 1 is for R equals to 1 to P plus 1 plus we are taken already that there are P non-overlapping subintervals, the closed interval A1 comma B1 comma the closed interval A2 comma B2 so on, the closed interval AP comma BP such that sum of their lengths delta R is less than epsilon by 2 times capital M minus small m. Therefore, this sigma R equal to 1 to P delta R, we are going to write it as less than epsilon by 2 times capital M minus small m. And sigma R equal to 1 to P capital M R minus small m R value is capital M minus small m. Since the sum r equal to 1 to p capital MR minus small MR is capital M minus small m, while taking the sum of the lengths of the subinterval, we are taken capital M minus small m, because the reason is the sum is capital M minus small m, and hence the capital M small m get cancelled. We get epsilon by 2. Here also p plus 1, b plus 1 get cancelled. We get epsilon by 2. For that sake only, we are taken the sum of their length is less than epsilon by 2 times capital M minus small m. This p plus 1 get cancelled. Capital M minus m and capital M minus small m get cancelled. That is, the above expression is equals to epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2. We know that epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2 is epsilon. That is, u of p comma f minus l of p comma f is equal less than equal. Therefore, 0 less than equal to u of p comma f minus l of p comma f is less than epsilon. This implies, by the necessary and sufficient condition for a bounded function to be Riemann integrable, the given function f is Riemann integrable. That is, f belongs to R of a comma b. That is, f is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b.